Hockey Talkin' YouTube channel with your hosts, Jonesy and Berkey, are honored to present
beautiful Seven Vines Vineyard in Delwood, Minnesota.
And the Herb Brooks Foundation.
Head coach Herb Brooks has made Minnesota a national power in college hockey.
Seven Vines Vineyard.
And the Herb Brooks Foundation present A Day in the Sun with Minnesota hockey greats. With John Masich.
Kelly Brooks Paradise.
Ron Peltier, Jim Boom, and Paul Otsky.
Are you ready for us?
We're all set.
All right, let's do it.
Okay.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Center of the line.
Yes. Yeah, it's
definitely going. Any rough checks?
Right. Johnny, you got the middle.
You got the center stick. You're the center.
Yes,
right?
Yes, you are.
You're always playing
center.
I'm right wing.
Next down to Ronnie.
Well, I was the center, but you know, I think you're
the
center here now.
Oh, man, you're the same
Paul Judge. Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
Wendy Anderson.
Yeah.
Herbie.
Johnny, you want to say a few words? You always have a few things to say.
Well, probably 20 years from... this fall, they had a hockey induction, Hall of Fame induction ceremony in Eveleth. So Herb came up on a Friday night. Ron came up. Good friend of Herbie, Paul Coppel from Michigan Tech, played on a line with Herbie. I don't know if you ever heard this story.
I may have. Fire away.
Well, Paulie. Coppel and Paul Johnson, they were on the line with Herbie. They were in the 64 Olympics, or maybe the, six in Austria. So Herbie played on the line with Ollie Johnson and Coppel. So Herbie said he used the same stick the whole season. And he was the designated checker on the line. I said, why? He said, well, Coppel couldn't and Paulie Johnson wouldn't. So there Herbie was. He said he never even got a shot in the warm-up. So they were all good buddies and good friends. But that was Herbie. And we never taught hockey. It was every other subject you could think about. But it was never hockey. But what a great guy, God, to have spent all that time with them and having mutual friends and relationships. And he loved Eveleth and Mariucci, of course, and the university, too. Yeah, so it's 20 years, actually, that Ron and I were in fivesome golf outing with them. He walked, 9 holes he played. Wouldn't ride in the cart. Ron, beautiful out here. What a perfect day for all of this. And seeing a full parking lot and people lined up here to make contributions to the Herb Brooks Foundation and the work they do to promote the sport and promote kids and families. So a privilege to be here.
I had the privilege of playing for Herbie. I'm not sure what it was like being a daughter of Herbie's, but I certainly know what it was like playing for him again. I don't know who happened to watch that little snippet, but it was true. And so with that, I'll give it to you, Kelly.
Well,
was that like that at home?
Well, no. I was a girl, so he was scared of me. He didn't know how to handle girls. I was a whole different thing to him. No, he was a fabulous father and obviously truly missed, but yeah, we really appreciate Seven Vine Vineyards including us and the relationship with Ron Peltier and actually his brother Skip. When we first started the foundation in 2004, Skip was our first executive director, his brother. So it's kind of fun to see this wrap around and come back in the circle with him. So we couldn't be more thrilled to be included.
We're so grateful for your dad and your family and what you guys have done for not just Minnesota, but the game of hockey.
Well, and it's funny that we're here in Delwood. I grew up, well, not grew up, we moved when I was three, but we lived in Montemita, right down the street from here. My neighbor was Warren Strelo. So we're kind of back in our old neighborhood too, where we you know, first lived, their first house. We are broadening the base of the pyramid, and which is really great is that we're giving opportunities for kids not just to play hockey, but we're getting calls from communities that want to have open hockey, that they need skates, rental skates, so we provide money for that. We've just provided money for Matt Olson, who was paralyzed in a hockey game, goodness, in junior hockey, I don't know, it's got to be 7 years ago. But we bought him a trailer so he can take this outdoor, I don't know what kind of track, it's this track trailer that he can go out in the fields and he can hunt, he can bow hunt. So we bought the trailer so he can get out. So we're doing other things that aren't just putting kids in hockey. And we just donated to Johnson High School. We're focused on that as well. So yeah, so we're doing a lot of really good things for the foundation. So it's pretty exciting. And you know, when we started the foundation 20 years ago, right when he passed away, we were one of the very few that provided hockey to inner city programs. Free hockey, free coaching, equipment. And now I'm so excited. There are so many programs that now, the Minnesota Wild, the USA Hockey has learned to skate for free. Most associations now have learned to play for free. So I mean, from 20 years ago to now, it's pretty cool how many opportunities there are for kids.
Well, thanks, John. It's hard to follow that and Jimmy, but it is a real pleasure to be here with a couple of great hockey legends and just to be sitting next to them. And, you know, John, as you're reflecting on, that 20 year ago event, I have some thoughts to contribute to that. But maybe before I do that, I think it should be said that, you know, I've had Herb influencing me and coaching me most of my, young adult life. First of all, he's a graduate of Johnson High School, where I, succeeded him. But he ended up being my peewee coach at Phelan, community center. He was my bantam coach, and I want to tell you, he was just as hard and just as demanding from the peewees as he was in all of his other coaching careers. He ended up being the assistant coach at the University of Minnesota while I was there, and he helped, along with the head coach Glenn Sonmore and Louie Nanny, get us to the national Final Four in Syracuse in 1971. And then he went on to other greater, coaching levels and successes, including the Olympics. But what I remember, John, about Herbie and about that 20-year ago event was that, yes, Herb always wanted to, find opportunities to improve and to do better. And if there was anything that I think we know about with Herb is that whatever accomplishments he had in the past, he didn't want to hear about them. Whatever successes, he was expecting you to build on that and to be better every day. And I will forever remember, a couple of comments about Herbie that sort of go with his personality. And Herb, Jimmy, you might remember this. I've told this to all of my buddies, that just our sort of unique things about Herbie is that when he really wanted to get under your skin, and there's probably nobody better in the world that knew how to get under your skin, is that Herb used to say, "Peltier, you're playing worse every day, and today you're playing like tomorrow." And if that wouldn't get anybody revved up, of course it wouldn't be just directed at me, although plenty of times that was it, but that, you know, he knew how to fire you up. And the other thing that I know about Herbie, and I know a lot of things about Herbie, is that, John, if you remember, you know, and the part that you didn't mention is Louie Nanny was there negotiating, and he had pretty much completed the negotiations for Herbie to go back to the New York Rangers. And the whole time we were talking, that was what was going on, and it was basically finalized then. And I remember Lou Nanny saying, you know, if we wrap this whole thing up, and it was really that weekend, he said, you better take the damn job. And of course, that never really happened because of Herbie on the way home fell asleep at the wheel, and what a tragedy for a tremendous guy. But I will say, when I think about Herb, I think about that, and I think, you know, what we all know about Herb is he was not happy unless he was unhappy. And the reason he was unhappy is because he expected more of anybody than, which is a tribute to the way he thought about people. He wanted everybody to continue to be better and better, and no matter where you are, there was still room to get better, and he wasn't going to be happy with you until you got better. So that's my story about Herb, or stories. I just say, you know, we're here to celebrate beautiful weather, October 1st, the legacy of Herbie, the Herbie Foundation, Herb Brooks Foundation, and to we've launched a brand new wine today, the State of Hockey, and the proceeds of the sale of that wine will go to the Herb Brooks Foundation. So a great man, a great hockey mind, deserves a State of Hockey wine and the contributions from today's sales. So thank you for being here.
Fellas, as we go along, Metzger, Kozak, and Casey are on the front line, the two Peltiers, and Zorotka for the Governors of St. Paul Johnson. Comes up to Zorotka off his skate. Metzger misses it. Comes over to Zorotka again. He shoots it.
Ron, thank you so much. Before we wrap, I know it's getting warm out here and we want to enjoy some of this great food and wine. I'd just like to ask Ron and Jim a couple questions. Ron, being a fellow Johnson Govy, can you share your favorite memory?
I was at the state tournament all 3 years. We were ranked number one in the state each of those years, 65 to 67. We lost in the final game. In my senior year, the only game we lost all year, we lost to Coleraine, and Mike Antonovich scored the winning goal. We should have won. Unfortunately, we didn't. Johnson has won it several times, but, you know, the people that followed me or that preceded me, the Herb Brooks, the Craig Falkmans, the David Brooks, the Schmaltz Bowers, you know, Krupe and Shattuck and Hughes all went on to the University of Minnesota, all excelled, and really kind of set the bar for people like myself, my brothers, and others that followed at Johnson, but it's guys like Herb Brooks that left an indelible mark.
Question goes to Jim Boo. Could you share just a little bit, Jim, about your national title win with the Golden Gophers?
Anybody that watched the movie Miracle, I think got an accurate portrayal of Herbie, you know, and that's just who Herbie was. Now I'm sitting with two guys that could play, and I was the guy that was down at the end of the bench by the sticks in the backup goalie. But I'll share you one Herbie story that sticks out in my mind. So I walked on over there just looking for an opportunity because my father, you know, went to the University of Minnesota, played some on the football team, and we're right dead in the middle of our first practice. He blows the whistle, he skates over to me, and I'm playing with people like Bill Baker, Joe Micheletti, you know, just Hall of Famers. And I thought, well, maybe I should try a move, you know? I mean, what the heck, you know? That's a hockey puck, I'm at the practice. Blows the whistle, stops everybody, skates over to me, picks up the puck, and he says, Boo, pretend we're in the Army. He said, this is a hand grenade. You got 4 seconds to get it to Vanelli, or it blows up and you're but goes to the bench. He said, so quit trying to think you're any good at this whole thing. You find Vanilla, you find Micheletti, you find somebody that knows what to do with a hockey puck, and you make sure that nobody's sitting in front of our net. That's your role here. Otherwise, go sit down. So he had that ability of getting more out of us, which I think we're eternally grateful for. I know I am, that Ron just said, that getting more out of everybody than we knew we had. And, you know, it's a privilege to know him. It was a privilege for me to spend some time playing for him, for the Herb Brooks Foundation, for us to be here, and for Ron to be kind enough to direct some of those resources to expanding the base of hockey. That's who Herb was. And a lot of times when you're done playing, the coach is just done talking to you. But Herbie was more of a friend after the hockey season was over than during the hockey season. So I can't say anything but being very, very grateful to have an opportunity to know him and to play for him, and then to sit with a couple of guys like this to you know, give him a little credit, you know, on a beautiful day like today. Hey, Johnny?
So what are you doing these days after your success at Elk River, University of Minnesota? You coached for a number of years.
So I got my start post-playing off the U.S. national team with the Hubbards. And back in the day, they owned the USHL St. Paul Vulcans. I was there for 2.5 years, and then I went to the University of Minnesota for 8 years. And then I was done there, and I started my own hockey camps. I kind of always had them going, mostly targeted towards goaltending. And then I did that for a number of years. In 1999, Darby Hendrickson was a player that I recruited at the U of M, and I was close to the family. And he told me, he said, I've got a new agent. He said, I think you should talk to him. And I said, about what? He said, well, getting into the business, I think you guys would hit it off. So I had the agent was Neil Sheehy, who played at Harvard, International Falls guy, and played in the National Hockey League for a number of years with my old high school teammate, Joel Otto. And Neil and I talked for about 12 hours one day, and we just decided he'd been in the business as an agent for a couple of years. He became an attorney while he was being an agent, and we hit it off right away. And that was right at the end of 99, and this is our 25th year together.
Wow.
Who are some of the guys you represent, Paul?
Right now?
Yeah.
Well, prominent guys, Anders Lee, who's the captain of the New York Islanders, Ryan Suter. We represent Nick Leddy.
Oh, sure.
Casey Middlestead, Rem Pitlick. We've got about 20 guys on NHL deals. And so, you know, it's that, and then it's a continuation of recruiting, and, you know, the business is changing quickly, so we're changing too.
Sure.
I know there are other things in life, but there's nothing that I've been around, and I've been around hockey my whole life, that I've seen with that kind of, like, camaraderie.
Yeah. Absolutely.
All right, Paul, thank you so much. Is there anything else you'd like to share with us?
No, I mean, this is such a great place, and the Herb Brooks Foundation is such a great cause. I know they've made some changes in how they're doing things, but if you want to get involved with a really, really great organization, Herb Brooks Foundation is fantastic. Of course, I knew Herb and Ron Peltier. I don't know if he said this, but Herb Brooks was his Bantam coach.
Oh, really?
So the east side of St. Paul Johnson, the connection to Herbie, the connection to the University of Minnesota, of course, his success, all of that kind of coming full circle and working together. It's a great thing. And I look for the Herb Brooks Foundation with a little bit different trajectory, from programming to scholarships and legacy stuff, is going to be something that's really going to, they're going to do really, really well. Dan Brooks is one of my best friends, so yeah. So I appreciate you having me on.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Paul.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thanks.
Here we are at Seven Vines, just a beautiful day on this day, honoring Herb Brooks and the Herb Brooks Foundation.
Okay, name is Marshall Burke, father of Paul Burke, and gave me and Marilyn the opportunity to meet some very important people that played a part in the hockey history in Minnesota.
Marshall's out here for making contact with old hockey stars, and he's having a great time.
Well, I'm Julene Wood, a friend of all of these people, and I'm here because I enjoy wine and wanted to come and see what was going on.
Excellent. I'm Doug, brother to Marilyn here. I played hockey in eighth grade on figure skates down at the farm. We flooded the farm rink, and we played hockey on Rydell skates because we were from Red Wing, and my parents knew Mr. Rydell.
Oh.
Yeah. They were friends, yeah.